Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Lahari from Department of Oral Medicine and Radiology and Oral Diagnostic and Surgical Sciences from Penang International Dental College. And today the topic of discussion is radiation safety and protection. The learning outcomes would be to explain in detail the methods of reducing dental exposure. Apply the principles of ALARA, which is as low as reasonably achievable in the practice of dental radiology. Describe in detail the methods of protecting the patient, radiology personnel and public from radiation. Dosimetry. The term dosimetry is used to in determining the quantity of the radiation exposure or dose. So the term dose is used to describe the amount of energy absorbed per unit mass at a site of interest. An exposure is a term used, it is a measure of radiation on the basis of its ability to produce ionization in air under standard conditions of temperature and pressure. So dose is the amount of energy and exposure is the measure of radiation. So together, the determining the quantity of radiation exposure is called as dosimetry. Now, there are other types of doses that we need to understand. Absorbed dose, equivalent dose and effective dose. The absorbed dose is a measure of energy absorbed by any type of ionizing radiation per unit mass of any type of matter. Equivalent dose is used to compare the biologic effects of different types of radiation on a tissue or organ. For example, 1 gray of neutrons or higher energy photons causes 5 times as much damage as 1 gray of X-ray photons. Effective dose, on the other hand, it is used to estimate the risk in humans. So risk from exposure of one region of the body can be compared to other regions and to the whole body as well. So if you've noticed, absorbed dose is measured in grays, equivalent in sieverts. And the next slide. Radiation units used to measure exposure are the SI units are generally coulomb. Older units are rontgens, but we now use coulomb per kg. Absorbed dose is grays, equivalent dose is sieverts, effective dose is sieverts, and radioactivity, which is something very different from radiation, is measured in becquerels. So we're not really discussing radioactivity here, so we will only be using the other terminology. The average annual effective dose of ionizing radiation. So how much amount of radiation does a human being receive on an average in a year? So in a year, the natural background radiation sums up to 2.4 millisieverts. Medical exposure, radiation resulting due to various reasons in medical conditions requiring X-rays and other types of medical exposure, is about 0.6 millisieverts. Consumer products and others is 0.01 millisieverts. So that sums up to a total of 3 millisieverts. So this 3 millisieverts is the average that a human being receives in a year effective dose of ionizing radiation. There are various sources of radiation exposure. The most important is a natural or background radiation. This is due to our existence on Earth itself, and that composes radon, which is a gas that's released from the Earth's crust. Space radiation, because of the sun and cosmic rays. Internal radionucleotides, which could be in food containing radionucleotides, for example uranium and thorium, existing in food substances which we probably are not aware of. And terrestrial radiation, which is there due to the soil. So all of this compose natural background radiation. Medical exposure due to imaging, and also therapeutic medical exposure, mainly CT scans, nuclear medicine. Consumer products, for example, there is radiation exposure due to cigarette smoking, building materials, air travel, mining and agriculture, and even combustion of fossil fuels. So just by living on planet Earth, you end up getting exposed to so many different sources of radiation. For example, a flight travel of 5 hours at an altitude of 12 kilometers results in a dose equivalent of 25 microsieverts. At sea level, the exposure to cosmic radiation, for example, is 0.24 millisieverts per year. and at an elevation of 1600 meters, this increases to 0.5 millisieverts per year. So this, though may be small, but it is important to note that there is a difference in the amount of exposure to radiation for someone living at a higher altitude. The other sources of radiation exposure could be because of occupational exposure. I mean, someone who's working in the field or as someone who's working in the area as medical personnel in X-ray facilities, dealing with airport baggage systems or commercial flight personnel, all of these people end up getting exposed to radiation, and that is called as occupational exposure. So all of this put together, as we saw in the previous slide, should sum up to an annual dose of about 3 millisieverts. So this is just to show you the distribution of the natural background radiation. In a year, you would receive about 2.4 millisieverts due to space, terrestrial, internal radionuclides or radon particles. The major one being radon, which is about 73%. Dentomaxillofacial radiology and estimated cancer risk. Now, why are we worried about radiation exposure? It's because radiation itself can lead to radiation-induced cancers. So if you were to look at dentomaxillofacial radiology, radiology of the head and neck region, then the basic principles of diagnostic imaging is that the benefits to the patient far overweighs the radiation-associated risk. Hence, the chance of radiation-induced cancer is unlikely, right? So cancer risk only increases with protracted radiation exposures greater than 100 millisieverts. So that's a lot of radiation. So only that much amount of radiation would actually induce cancer risk. So otherwise, routine dentomaxillofacial radiology, the diagnostic imaging that is done, hardly gives any risk to the patient. And this is very important to communicate with your patient. It is important to make your patient understand that the benefits of taking an X-ray or doing diagnostic imaging is far more than actually any risk associated with cancer. So, example, in a pregnant patient, when required, emphasis to the patient that the fetal dose to the unborn baby from diagnostic dental radiographs is very low. It's just approximately 42,000 fold lower than the threshold dose for deterministic effects on the fetus. So we will cover deterministic and stochastic effects of radiation in a different chapter. But what I want to make you understand here is that the radiation dose to an unborn fetus is way low, 42,000 times lower than the amount of radiation actually required to cause any birth defects due to radiation. So it is goes without saying that dental radiographs are safe, but nevertheless it's important that you protect your patient, and in this chapter we will see how best to protect your patient from unnecessary radiation. So if you look at the recommended dose limits for human exposure to ionizing radiation, there are certain guidelines laid down by the International Commission on Radiologic Protection. Now, they have divided these dose limits into occupational exposure and public or non-occupational exposure. So if you're in the occupation, that is you are medical personnel who are involved with radiology, then you are allowed an annual effective dose of 20 millisieverts averaged over a defined 5-year period. And the cumulative effective dose should not be more than 100 millisieverts in 5 years, and should not exceed 50 millisieverts in any single year. The annual equivalent dose to, let's say, targeting the lens of the eye, the dose to the lens of the eye, should be not be more than 20 millisieverts averaged over a defined 5-year period, and should not exceed 50 millisieverts in any single year. Whereas to the skin or the hands and feet, the dose limit is 500 millisieverts. In pregnant workers, it's 1 millisievert to embryo or fetus after declaration of pregnancy. So naturally, pregnant workers, the dose limit is much lower than the other normal people, right? So public exposure or non-occupational exposure, the annual effective dose limit is just 1 millisievert. And the annual equivalent dose to the lens of the eye is 15 millisieverts, and to the skin is 50 millisieverts. A mix you are now gives a question in your mind, is that why is it that the public is allowed lesser radiation exposure than occupational exposure? It is simply the reason is that as public, you are not supposed to be getting exposed to ionizing radiation any more than this, right? So whereas occupational dose limit, it is understandable that because of certain reasons, you could get exposed to radiation. And of course, you need to take precaution if it exceeds beyond this. So that is the reason why. If the public is getting exposed to unnecessary radiation, that means that there is something wrong. Either the patient has had too many episodes or too many incidences of radiotherapy, or has undergone too many examinations of radiographic examinations, or is there is probably a leak, or there could be a natural disaster where there is a radiation leak. Moving on. Implementing radiation protection and reducing dental exposure is the most important aspect of this entire topic. There are certain guiding principles in radiation protection, and they are guided by the principle of justification, optimization, and dose limitation. That means it's important to justify why do we need to take the dental radiograph, and it's important to optimize the radiation dose, keeping in mind ALARA, which is as low as reasonably achievable. We're not going to expose our patient to more radiation dose, and also the principle of dose limitation, which we have just looked into earlier. So with this in mind, patient protection becomes an important aspect. So the recommendations for reducing dental exposure can be, it includes patient selection criteria, conducting the radiographic examination itself. And there are various methods which are included in this. Let's look at each one of them individually. In patient selection criteria, it's important to note that radiograph must be taken only after thorough history taking and clinical examination. So unless we have done the history taking and clinical examination, arrived at a provisional diagnosis, only then it's important to take a radiograph if it aids further in achieving or arriving at the final diagnosis, and the radiograph helps in the management and treatment planning of the patient. So it's important to avoid unnecessary exposure to the patient. Also, obtain lowest dose imaging that would provide necessary diagnostic information. For example, an intraoral radiograph is enough to determine dental caries, and you wouldn't want to unnecessarily expose the patient to a panoramic radiograph or perhaps a CBCT just to identify that there is dental caries in the patient. So if you look at the typical effective dose from radiographic examination, you will note that based on the type of radiograph, the effective dose changes, and then we have tried to equate it here to the equivalent background exposure in days. That means that using a rectangular collimator, if you've taken posterior bite wings with an F-speed film or a PSP, that is photostimulable phosphor plate, then you are going to expose the patient, effective dose would be 5 microsieverts, and which equals to 0.6 days of life on earth in plain words. So similarly, you will notice that a full mouth X-ray with F-speed films causes an effective dose of 40 microsieverts, whereas with a sensor, CCD sensor, is just 20. And a round collimator exposes the patient to a lot more radiation than does a rectangular collimator. Interesting to note that a panoramic radiograph causes only 20 microsieverts of effective dose, in comparison to a full mouth radiograph, which also causes 20, and a full mouth with round collimator causing 100. But that doesn't mean that you replace a panoramic radiograph for intraoral radiographs. It's only done when each of them has their own individual indications, and it's important that it is followed. Cephalometric X-ray requires 5 microsieverts. Chest X-ray, on the other hand, 100 microsieverts. Cone beam CT, if you're using a small field of view, then it's about 50, but if it's a full arch, then it can go up to 100 or sometimes even more than that. A CT scan of the entire maxillofacial region would cause you about 650 microsieverts effective dose, whereas that of a head is reaching up to 2000 microsieverts or otherwise 2 millisieverts. And that of an abdomen and pelvis CT would be much, much more, reaching up to 20 millisieverts. So moving on to looking at film and diagnostic digital imaging, Good radiographic practices includes use of fast film receptor compatible with diagnostic tasks. For example, F-speed film or digital imaging would definitely utilize lesser amount or cause lesser amount of radiation exposure to the patient in comparison to some of the older films. So here in this picture, you're looking at examples of different types of sensors or different types of image receptors. You have a film, you have a PSP, and you have different types of digital sensors as well, right? So E-speed films are twice as fast or sensitive as D-speed films, and 50 times faster than the older, the first time, the ones which we introduced long ago in the 1920s, A-speed films. Thus, the exposure time for an A-speed film was about 9 seconds just for one dental radiograph, in comparison to E-speed film which takes 0.2 seconds and an F-speed film which just takes 0.015 seconds. The F-speed film requires 75% of exposure as E-speed film and only 40% exposure of the D-speed film. Digital imaging, on the other hand, there is patient dose reduction of 75% compared with D-speed film, and 50% of E-speed film and 40% of F-speed films can be achieved. So this gives you an understanding that digital imaging is by far the best in terms of reducing radiation exposure to the patient, and followed closely by the F-speed films. Film-based panoramic encephalometric radiograph is now being replaced by digital sensors. This is a picture of our clinic, which shows you that we have use only digital panoramic or extraoral radiography. The older film-based extraoral radiography used to use contemporary intensifying screens, which were inside this cassette, which were made up of rare earth elements like gadolinium and lanthanum. And this actually decreases patient exposure by 55%. In those without the intensifying screens. Moving on to source to skin distance. Now, what we mean by source to skin distance is the distance from where the x-rays are generated to the skin of the patient. So it's important to use long source to skin distance, otherwise called as focal spot to the film distance. So this distance from the patient to the source should be between 20 cm and 40 cm, so 8 inches to 16 inches. So that's good if you have a long cone, which gives you a longer distance. And they are appropriate in intraoral radiography and can reduce patient exposure by 10 to 25%. And hence, it's important to use a machine which has a long cone. It's self-explanatory in this picture, where you see that a shorter cone actually exposes the patient to a larger radiation or larger field of radiation in comparison to a longer cone, which exposes the patient to shorter field of or smaller area of radiation exposure. Now, this is further achieved with the usage of a collimator. Collimators are generally made of lead, and the position indicating device in any x-ray machine is lined with lead, and it also doubles as a collimator. Apart from that, there could be collimation inside the machine itself. Now, the use of a rectangular collimator is recommended for periapical and bite wings, and this decreases radiation dose by 5-fold as compared to the circular one. It reduces area of patient skin exposure by 60% over that of round collimation, which gives you an area of over 7 centimeters diameter. Now, if you look at the pictures here, you can understand that rectangular collimator can be incorporated into the image holder or the receptor itself. You know, the where you have a rectangular area through which the x-rays are being sent out to the patient, and this entire rim must be made of lead, so it doesn't allow any x-rays to pass through. Effectively, you have only a small rectangular window through which the x-rays are reaching the film. You could also, in comparison to a rounder one, which allows a lot more radiation to reach the film. You could have the collimator attached to the aiming cylinder, which is also called as a position indicating device. So you could have a rectangular collimator which comes as an insert to your existing cone. And you could also replace the entire circular collimator with a rectangular one, such that it gives you a small window for x-rays to pass through. Obviously, the one with the rectangular collimator reduces radiation, no doubt, but also increases, or it has to, you know, go with the accuracy of how you take the radiographs, because now you have a smaller area of radiation exposure. So keeping in mind It's important to note that the area of circular field is almost 3 times larger than the area of the number 2 size intraoral film, right? So if you notice here, this green circle is having a larger area of exposure in comparison to the black rectangle. So that is what I've been trying to explain to you, that long cone with a rectangular collimator reduces the area of exposure to the patient. This is again a picture which I have taken off the internet, which shows you that the round collimator versus a rectangular collimator. A round collimator uses gives you a larger, wider area of exposure in comparison to a rectangular collimator, which exposes a very small area, a narrow area. Moving on to filtration. Filter is made up of aluminium, unlike the collimator, which is made up of lead. The role of a filter is to reduce low energy photons with less penetration power. These are being removed by the filter. When a 2 mm aluminium filter is used, there is approximately 20% reduction exposure as compared to no filtration at all. Recommended filtration in the path of dental X-ray beam must be equal to 1.5 mm of aluminium for a machine operating at 50 to 70 kVp, is generally the intraoral X-ray machines. And for a larger X-ray machine, you might require about 2.5 mm of aluminium. Now, as filter is something which is incorporated within the X-ray machine itself, the total filtration would be a combination of inherent as well as added filtration, all of this combining to either 1.5 or to 2.5 mm of aluminium. The inherent filtration comprises the glass envelope, the oil, the window of the house tube housing, and 0.5 mm. And the added filtration, which is there at the position indicating device, like a barrier material and the filter, would be about the rest, would be the added aluminium that meets the requirements. So next we move on to another important aspect of protecting your patient, is the usage of protective aprons and thyroid collars. Now, it's important to understand that the thyroid gland is susceptible to radiation exposure during dental radiography due to its anatomical location, because it's located very close to the lower arch, and exposure to the maxillary or the mandibular radiograph ends up exposing the thyroid gland, particularly in children in whom the thyroid gland is highly sensitive to radiation induced cancer. It's important that precaution is taken that the thyroid gland is covered or protected during dental radiography. So to protect this, we utilize lead aprons with existing thyroid collar. There are various types of aprons available. This brown one here is a lead apron with the thyroid collar. This is a lead apron without thyroid collar. And this is a lead apron which is front and back protection, which is utilized in panoramic radiography. So the lead apron actually gives 90% to 95% protection. It contains 0.1 to 0.5 mm lead. But the problem with the lead apron is that it is heavy. Lead is supposed to be a poisonous material, and it's a heavy metal and considered as poisonous, and the waste generated after the apron is used, probably after it is redundant and no use and not used anymore, could be hazardous. So disposing this lead apron could also be a critical factor. Now, recently there have been lead free aprons that have come into the market, which are made with a combination of antimony, tin, tungsten and bismuth. These materials also provide 98% protection as compared to lead, but the weight is only 60%. So which means that they are lighter, they are easily recyclable, and they also come under non-hazardous waste. So it's mandatory that the patient is made to wear a lead apron and thyroid collar for dental examination. Then when we are moving on now to film and sensor holders, when you're placing the film or the sensor in the patient's mouth for radiographic examination, it's important to use a holder. This improves alignment and also reduces errors and retakes. This image here shows you examples of intraoral holders for films. This is a snap array holder, and this is a RIN XCP holder for holding films. Whereas the others are all various varieties of digital sensor holders available in the market. And there are many more such varieties which help you hold different types of sensors. There are nowadays a single holder can hold various different types of sensors also. So they're called as universal holders. kilovoltage and milliampere second. The optimum operating potential of dental X-ray units is between 60 to 70 kilovoltage peak. So the KVP stands for kilovoltage peak. And the kilovoltage actually influences the image contrast and patient dose. So a majority of the X-ray units come with either 60 or between 60 to 70 KVP. Now a constant potential being fully rectified, high frequency and direct current dental X-ray units can provide radiographs with lower kilovoltage and at a reduced level of radiation. So it's important that your machine has a kilovoltage between 60 to 70 KVP and uses direct current and constant potential. The image density is controlled by the quantity of X-rays produced. And the quantity is calculated by milliamperage or the current into or times the exposure, which is the milliampere second. Now the exposure time is the most crucial factor in determining the diagnostic quality of the image amongst all these three factors. So the kilovoltage and milliampere second and the exposure time are something which you can adjust in your nowadays machines. So while the kilovoltage you need to set between 60 to 70 based on the manufacturer's recommendation, as well as the milliamperage which would already be determined for your machine, the only other crucial factor which is adjustable is the exposure time, and that is most important in determining how good the quality of your image is. Film processing and interpreting images. Now again, film processing must follow manufacturer recommendations. It's important that you follow that so that you do not end up with the images which are non-diagnostic. Poor processing techniques leads to poor diagnostic quality. We end up doing retakes and increase the radiation exposure to the patient and ultimately increase costs. It's important that the dentist should view radiographs under appropriate conditions for analysis and diagnosis. The one we mean by appropriate condition, for film images, it's important to use a semi-darkened room with a viewer. An X-ray viewer can be the one attached to your chair or the one with which is portable and allows light to be transmitted through the films. So that would mean that you're able to visualize the image very clearly. And sometimes you may need to use a magnifying lens or a glass to detect the smallest changes. When you're viewing digital images, it's important that you use a computer screen in a darkened environment. That would mean that you're viewing images in appropriate condition and it's less likely that you make errors in diagnosis. Moving on, now we've looked at all the conditions on how to reduce radiation exposure using the patient selection criteria as well as the conducting the examination or radiographic examination part of it. Let's move on to how to protect personnel. Personnel means dentist staff, right? So it's important that dentists and staff who are occupationally exposed to the radiation receive protection. How do you do that? It's with the help of lead barriers, which have lead glass windows, so you can view the patient during the exposure and remind the patient not to move and see that they are seated in the right place or they're standing in the right place. And you could also use the position and distance rule. Now, this is a very important rule. It's important to understand how the rule goes. Patients, the dentist or the operator, the one who is operating the X-ray unit, should stand at least 6 feet or 2 meters from the patient at an angle of 90 to 135 degrees to the central ray. More about it in the next coming slides. And also, it's important to use personal monitoring devices. When we're talking about barriers in a radiology room, now it's important that the radiology room is constructed by professional people who are in the area of radiology, and specifications have to be followed for radiology room, and there are a lot of permissions and the authorities need to grant you permission to for your X-ray machine as well as the location and the room itself. So the wall of the radiology room is generally made up of either 3 inches of concrete or gypsum wall board or 3 times 16 inches of stainless steel or 1 mm of lead. So if you notice here, these pictures indicate to you that there is at least 3 inches of concrete and more than that. And then this room indicates that this door is, this is in our clinic, it has a leaded door and in fact the entire radiology room has a lead lining. Right, so barium plaster or barium concrete can also be used to line the walls. This is an example of a radiology room lined with barium plaster. Leaded glass windows can also be put into the barrier, lead barriers, so that you can visualize your patient. So this is an entire barrier which is made up of lead. And so the operator needs to stand behind the barrier during the X-ray exposure so that the operator himself or herself doesn't get exposed to radiation. In case there is no barrier available, then the position distance rule comes into play. And the operator should stand at least 6 feet from the patient, which is 2 meters, at an angle of 90 to 135 degrees to the central ray of the X-ray beam when the exposure is being made. Which means that, let's say you're taking an anterior radiograph, then this would be the best position to stand. If this is the central ray of exposure, then at an angle of 90 to 135 to the central beam. If you're taking a posterior radiograph, then this would be the best position to stand because it would be at an angle of 90 to 135 from the central beam and at a distance of 6 feet or 2 meters. Personal monitoring devices are devices used by officers or doctors who are working in the radiology room, working with radiology equipment, and this is to understand the amount of exposure or the dose that the patient, the doctor or the radiology personnel, the radiology staff are receiving over a period of a month and cumulatively over a period of year. So there are various examples of dosimeters available. All of these are examples. They could be pocket dosimeters, digital electronic dosimeters, film badge like the one shown here, thermoluminescent dosimeters like the one here, and the more recent and more widely used OSLD, the optically stimulated luminescent dosimeter. For example, the one which we use in our clinic, which measures radiation exposure over a period of 1 month, and after every 1 month you get the reading as to how much amount of radiation exposure has happened, and if it is too much, then you get a warning letter which says that there is something wrong and you've got unnecessarily exposed to radiation, right? So and there are after that there are precautions to be taken further. Radiation monitoring can also be done for the entire room, radiology room, or during the setup of the radiology equipment during constructions, or as an annual quality check for the X-ray machine itself. Now these can be monitored with meters like ionizing chambers, thimble chambers, and Geiger-Müller counters. So these will help, like for example, you can see these men who are trying to measure the amount of radiation that could be received and whether this barrier door is actually preventing or protecting the personnel from radiation or no. Ultimately, it is important that you maintain quality, and quality assurance is something which should be checked annually and regularly, and combined with continuing education is important for the radiology department as well as the dentist to understand that he or she needs to be alert and also updated about the latest guidelines, and the various acts and regulations that need that the patients, doctors need to be aware of. One of the most important being guidelines on radiation safety in dentistry. You can follow these websites for understanding these guidelines more in detail. In conclusion, dental practitioners should not be complacent about the low risk of dental radiography. They are professionally responsible to use radiography appropriately in their practices and to maintain good, safe radiation procedures at all times. So it's important that you follow the guidelines and keep your patients safe. At the same time, stay safe. So these are the references that I have used in my lecture. And thank you for listening to me. If you have any doubts, you can email me.